Light My Fire definitely was the Doors' first big hit.
A catchy tune, instant success for the Doors with this song.
Light My Fire turned out to be a pretty successful single for the Doors and one of the songs they'll always be remembered for. But it wasn't written as a single. They basically came in, created an album, and thought about the commercial possibilities afterwards.
Interestingly enough, a lot of people assume Jim Morrison wrote that song, but actually Robbie wrote that song.
When I talked to Krieger about Light My Fire, he said it was the first song that he ever wrote.
They had to do a radio edit of it because the song was way too long for AM radio. And people started hearing it on AM radio. It went way up the charts. And the FM players, all the stations could play the long version.
They didn't care about it fitting on radio, and so they just let it go. And when you listen to it, there's a huge long organ solo, and you think, well, this is going to finish at some point, and it doesn't, it carries on. And then when it gets to the end, you think, right, it's going to go back into the chorus, and it doesn't, it then goes to a guitar solo. And there's an equally as long guitar solo. And so it's just this huge trade-off of music, which is, you know, absolutely brilliant, and that's why it may be a long song, but it keeps it interesting.
The song was originally 7 minutes long, but they had to make a single length, get it down to about 3 minutes time, which they cut out the keyboard solo and Robbie Krieger's guitar solo.
It was a real sign of the time type song. It came out, and you know, throughout the year 1967, that was their hit. And a lot of people, when they play stuff about the 60s, they'll play that song because it really encapsulates an era.
The song performed live would go on and on even longer. I think the highlight of the Doors was their live performance. People didn't really get to see how great they were until they saw them on TV or saw them live. They heard the single, catchy tune, but when they saw them live, true Doors fans loved the fact that Krieger's solo went on, or Ray Manzarek's keyboard solo went on, as it did on the album.
Fantastic track, bit of Latin in there. And what's great about it, really, I suppose, is they're taking, because they were a Los Angeles band, they must have been hearing quite a lot of South American Latin-type music from where Los Angeles is placed in the world. And that was seeping into their style of playing. And it wasn't a particularly popular style at that time. You know, in that era, bands were playing much more blues-based things, but they weren't scared to introduce a different sort of style. So I really, you know, with Jim's voice, that sort of raw bluesy voice on top of this Latin type groove, it was exciting. It was a very different type of tune.
Ray Manzarek, the keyboard player, came up with the signature introduction, and John Densmore came up with the drum beat, and Jim came up with some of the lyrics in conjunction with Robbie Krieger. So it was really a band effort, and one which I think was justly, or is still very much justly associated with them.
You know, the day destroys the night, night divides the day. Try to run, try to hide, break on through to the other side. Break on through to the other side. Break on through to the other side, yeah. We chased our pleasures here, dug our treasures there. But can you still recall the time we cried? Break on through to the other side. Break on through to the other side.
Break on Through is the first song on the album. Any Doors fan, or true Doors fan, will tell you that this is the true essence of the Doors. It was Break On Through that led them to the Doors name.
They figured that they were the Doors of Perception, which linked the known and the unknown. So Breaking On Through had a very specific meaning. Break on through to the other side. Go through the doors from the world that you know, the world that you're certain of, to an exciting world of possibilities. So Break On Through, while not perhaps their best known track, was one that was quite significant for them.
I actually played with a band in the early 90s. And live, it went down a storm. The crowd used to love it, probably because it was a Doors tune. But one thing that the Doors had that was exciting was they were really good live, and they were exciting live with Jim's performance. And the songs were sort of structured for live performance, I feel, in many ways. And when I used to play it with the band, as I said, it went down a storm. It was good fun to play, simple but very effective. Oh, yeah!
Break On Through, that was a song that the Doors performed a lot in the bars. And it's got a neat beat to it, very different.
The drummer opens with a slight jazz riff. In comes the keyboards, kind of accenting with the drummer. To make that a little bit thicker, the guitar player mimics the keyboard player. Suddenly the song is starting to swell. It's waiting, and then all of a sudden a strange sound, like a moaning guitar or a moaning bass sound, just kind of goes in and out, kind of just making that sexual throbbing sound. And then the voice, absolutely incredible. What a great way to open an album.
1967, The Doors' debut album, self-titled, starts with a 2.5 minute song called Break On Through. 2.5 minutes of perfection. What a way to introduce side one of a record from the Doors.
That was the one song that Elektra was really pushing as their first single. So the first time that they did a tour up and down the coast here on the West Coast, that was a song they played a lot, and that was the song that they were pushing. And it did get a lot of radio airplay, but it wasn't until Light My Fire came out that that's when everyone started taking notice of the Doors. But it's a really good song, and it's a great way to lead off the first album.
The Alabama song was the first of two cover songs that they did on the album. It was actually taken from an opera entitled Mahogany.
It was a Brecht and Wilde song, and Ray Manzarek had an album of their songs, and I think it just took the imagination, took the attention of Jim Morrison, so he thought he could make something of it, and clearly it became one of their more off-the-wall tracks.
My wife Dorothy had the record, and we used to listen to the record, the original cast recording, and we used to listen to the record all the time, and she said, why don't you do the Whiskey Bar? And Jim said, yeah!
We all loved it, and it had this great kind of German oompa kind of beat, and we adapted it for the Doors.
How many times would people assume the Doors, a psychedelic band from Los Angeles, would be doing this oompa-pa song?
This just shows the extent and the range of this band, from straight ahead bar blues to something that's just kind of a little left of center.
I thought, this is too weird. But then I got into it and I found out about Kurt Weill, and we did it so well, people thought we wrote it, and we had to correct them all the time and say, no, this is from a German opera.
The inclusion of Alabama Song on the Doors' debut record, I think that was at the height of Jim Morrison's wanting people to believe that he was a poet and trying to, through music, show his breadth of knowledge, covering the song.
When you got to Alabama Song on that first Doors record, you got a glimpse into the quirky world of the Doors, melodically and musically. It was a bit off-kilter.
Alabama Song, for me, I think, is an example of when the Doors could sort of just create like a scene in your mind if you just closed your eyes and listened to it. I've never been to Alabama, but you really felt like you walked into some old saloon with a wooden floor and there's dust all over the place, and you walk up and order your whiskey.
It was a song that Jim Morrison probably could have or should have written, because it talks about going to the whiskey bar. And if we don't get to the whiskey bar, we may die, which was very Jim Morrison, even though it was taken from an opera at the time.
While it wasn't out of the ordinary for the time, a lot of people were experimenting in music with that kind of thing. I just think that it took it to another level for the Doors.
It was really neat. It just showed how diverse they could be. I think it's still pretty popular today when you still hear it on FM radio quite a bit. And again, it just showed another side of the Doors that you weren't expecting after listening to the rest of the album. It was very, very different. Yeah!
Thank you.
darling, ha ha.
Backdoor Man. The Doors cut their teeth playing in different bars around the Los Angeles area, like the London Fog, and then they got their residency at the Whiskey A Go-Go. But when they first started playing, that was one of the mainstay songs that they would play when they were in the bars. And the freshness of their first album was because they'd been playing those songs for at least a year and a half, almost every night. So when they went in the studio, they just blasted through these songs because they were very, very, very fresh. They knew all these songs inside and out. And Backdoor Man was one that would really get a rise out of the crowd when they were playing it live. So they knew that they had to have that one on their album.
This is the reason why they stayed American, staying true to blues. I think they worked this song onto the album because I believe it was a crowd pleaser.
This was a track where they really got down to their roots. Not perhaps a typical Doors track, but one that I suspect went down rather well in concert.
For me, it is one of my favorite Doors songs, just partly by Morrison's performance, but you have to give it to Krieger on this one.
Robbie Krieger quickly proved with a song like Backdoor Man that he had a firm footing in the blues and could deliver it both tonally on the guitar and with incredible taste in terms of the notes he chose to use and the way he chose to bend them, unlike a lot of people playing rock and roll.
He's a fireball of electricity, and I think knowing how much of a blues fan Robbie Krieger was, I think that he had to have a hand in the inclusion of that on the debut record.
I found that song on an album by John Hammond Jr. And it was actually written by Willie Dixon. Most songs were. John Hammond did this great version of it on his album, and it became one of our favorite songs.
A fantastic song. I'm not quite sure how they got away with it, because it's quite a rude song if you listen to the lyrics.
Backdoor Man is about anal intercourse.
This song also, lyrically, had a little bit to do with Jim's life, because I know for a fact that Jim, through many books and through interviews, videos that I've seen, he used the back door.
You really choked in our eat show, pork and beans. I eat more chicken than any man ever seen. Yeah! That's all right! Me and Doris, not a sucker, little girl, understand.
It's about a guy who eats more chicken than you've ever seen. You men come home and you eat your pork and beans. I'm the back door man. You men are gone. I sneak in the back door. I eat more chicken. And it's about a gigolo. It's a Lothario. It's a gigolo. It's a blues gigolo song.
Jim Morrison made it his own. He put a lot of menace into the song. I think the men, when watching him perform, had no idea what he was talking about, but the women in the audience certainly knew what he was talking about.
Yeah. You love me, don't you, baby? I knew you would. Touch me. Don't play with me.
You could tell by the way Jim sang it that he'd been around the block. You men eat your dinner, eat your pork and beans. I eat more chicken than any man ever seen. So he was singing from experience.
This is the end, beautiful friend. This is the end, my only friend. Of our elaborate plans, of everything that stands.
look into your eyes again. Can you picture what will be so limitless and free, desperately in need of some stranger's hand in a desperate land?
The end is one of the Doors' major pieces, 11 minutes or so long on an album, sometimes even longer than that in concert.
The end started out just to be a little love song. Jim and I were over at my parents' house for a couple of weeks because they left town. And we wrote a whole bunch of songs at that time. And the end was just, this is the end, beautiful friend, this is the end, my only friend. And it was just a couple verses, you know. And so we would do it in person, and then all of a sudden it started getting longer and longer.
I think it was the first rock song that was over 10 minutes. So we were kind of proud of breaking the 3-minute barrier.
It was a real showcase, I think, for the band, you know. And when they played it live, they'd often, in their first year or so as a band, would end their shows with the end.
What it encapsulates about the Doors is almost the fact that you can't be quite sure what they're talking about. Is it the end of a relationship? Is it the end of the world? It could be more or less the end of anything, innocence, childhood. You can take it and you can make what you want from it. Obviously, Jim Morrison thinks he knows what it's about, but maybe he's the only one who can say for sure.
There was something really quite unusual about that particular song. You can tell the Doors used to jam a lot and used to turn, songs would come out of the jams. And I think Robbie Krieger's, you know, Spanish-y, sort of slightly Indian-y influences created the template, the backdrop for this song.
The actual riff is, I think it's kind of in a drop D tune, and it kind of goes. That kind of thing. And then it stays on that one, the interesting thing about it is it stays on that one note, really, with just him adding these little touches as well. And it's not until Jim Morrison's vocals come in that the song actually changes chords. So when the vocals come in, it goes from that D. To a C, and then back to the D. It's a very straightforward song, but it's just having the atmosphere to play the song, and the way it was produced and the way it was played shows the skill of the band.
And there was a sound like silverware being dropped on linoleum, and then somebody ran through the room and they said, have you seen the accident outside? And everybody said, hey man, have you seen the accident outside? Have you seen the accident outside? 7 people took a ride. 6 bachelors and their bride. 7 people took a ride.
This is a song that toys with you. This is a song that takes you to a peak and then brings you back down. I'm impressed by the journey this song takes you through.
It was this song that got them their record deal. They were playing the Whiskey A Go-Go, probably the most famous live rock venue in the world in Los Angeles. And it was the lyrics that made people go and perk up. So it was this song that record executives heard them performing at the Whiskey, where they said, we like this, let's talk to them about a record deal.
Morrison's sort of poetry on the top of it and managing to get the darkness of the era across. They did it so beautifully, and they managed to capture it in the studio, which is quite exceptional. And it really is, even listening to it today, it's a fantastically dark and, you know, unusual piece of music.
It was just sort of a hint of things to come, you know, from Jim Morrison and the things that were inside his head.
It's definitely a good way to end the first album, a very good track.
It's a track that certainly in concert took on huge significance, and I think it's a track that a lot of people will remember the Doors album and the Doors the band for.
Love me a few times, babe. Love me twice today. Love me a few times, baby. I'm gone away. Love me two times, yeah. One for tomorrow, one just for today. Love me two times, I'm gone away. Love me one time, babe. Could not speak.
Strange Days came out in 1967, and it was sort of the Doors' darkest album.
Here's an album that confused me, and I enjoyed it. It was surreal. It was psychedelic.
It was almost impossible for the Doors to follow up arguably one of the best debuts in rock history, but I think they did it with Strange Days.
They had a far better studio setup for the second album. They had all of 8-track recording equipment. And they were very keen to make an album that was an advance on their first. Musically, perhaps in a way it was. In other ways, it obviously, very few second albums make the impact of the first. But Strange Days wasn't a bad effort.
Love me one time, babe. I could not speak. Love me one time, baby. Yeah, my knees got weak. Well, love me two time, girl. Bless me out through the week. Love me two time, I'm gone away.
The song Love Me Two Times starts with a blues riff, which lots and lots of other bands are using, somehow manages to metamorphosis into a sort of pop cadence for the chorus. And they also, I think the Doors used to use a lot is what's called crotchet triplets. Bat, 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 bat against the bat, 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 do, 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 boom, da, do. So they had a shuffle going on, crotchet triplets, blues lick, and sort of the other thing they used to use quite a lot was a sort of slightly odd classical thing, which I think Ray Manzarek used to bring to the band in his keyboard playing. Somehow they'd make all these ingredients work, and this is one of the tracks that's typical of this.
The riff for Love Me Two Times is based around an E chord, and he's basically using the open strings in between. So, but it's the way he's putting them, it just makes a great riff. So the main riff goes. What he was doing there was just moving up to like an A major shape, and then it's the bridge bit, using a lot of seventh chords, so it goes to a D, D7, C7, and what I was doing there was just a run G, D7, which is giving it that ring, C7 and B7, rather than using straight chords, which would have just sounded normal, you know. He's using that, which is, the Doors used a lot of that, you know, I think because of the, to complement the keyboard perhaps, you know.
Love Me Two Times is one of those Doors staples. It has everything. I think the neatest part is that it has a harpsichord solo from Ray Manzarek. Throwing in that, just what the Doors did, they took what was pretty much a straight ahead song and they added just a little bit of, you know, obscurity to it, and they throw in a harpsichord solo. Ray Manzarek, who was fantastic on the keys as always, but I think that he, every member of the band brought something to the Doors music, and that was Ray Manzarek's moment to shine, I believe.
Love Me Two Times is considered a mini masterpiece. This really was a big hit for the band. It had that psychedelic flavor, but also a bit of R&B flavor with a great little driving beat to it. A guaranteed hit for the band. They probably didn't know it when recording it, but as soon as it was heard by the fans and non-fans, it gave the band new fans who heard the song, went, this is great. What is it? A definite hit from the get-go.
Love Me Two Times, it's a really good song. I think it's got a lot of really good feel to it. And, you know, it's got some neat keyboarding in there. It's got some neat drum rolls.
The standard way to play a rock and roll shuffle would be da 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 da. And I found myself going I play it all across the drums.
It's a very good single, you know, in less than 3 minutes, you got a really good song that has lots of power and lots of energy.
Music's over. When the music's over, yeah. When the music's over, turn out the light, turn out the light, turn out the light.
When the Music's Over, for me, a fantastic Doors song, one of the best ever, in my opinion.
When the music's over, starts with a sort of blues riff, sort of dirty blues riff, and develops then into this sort of Jimmy Smith, the organ player's sort of funky-ish groove, and then goes off into another area that only the Doors would take it to.
Ray Manzarek really showing his skills as playing the bass line on his keyboard.
When the music's over, it will always be bookended with the end, because it's a similar kind of long, drawn-out piece that could be made into a concert set piece.
Another epic track, not as long as the end, just over 11 minutes long. The end was 11 and a half minutes.
When the music's over was one of our killer long songs.
What have they done to the earth? What have they done to our fair sister? Ravaged and plundered, ripped her and bit her. Stuck her with knives in the side of the dawn and tied her with fences and dragged her down.
Jim Morrison would go off on one for minutes at a time. In view of that, perhaps the studio recording would be considered a little bit of a prototype, but it's certainly quite a track for Doors fans, and particularly because the music finished very abruptly, as one that in retrospect is regarded as a bit of a signature tune.
When the music's over, you're dead. That's basically how I think these guys, and Morrison in particular, saw the song.
For the time, and there was a lot of race riots and protest music, this is a great protest song, because as everyone knows, in it, Jim Morrison screams, "We want the world and we want it now." You know, dealing with political issues was nothing new for the Doors, but I think this is one of the best examples of how they did it with a great song and a great message.
We want the world and we want it now. Right, Mama?
I think probably a lot of these songs, Paul Rothchild still producing, he'd give them freedom in the studio to jam a little bit and improvise, and these things would come out of it. Because it doesn't sound like someone's come to the studio and gone, here's the riff, man, let's build a song on it. It sounds like they've just started playing. And Jim Morrison was writing lyrics all the time, whether he was in the studio or not. And so I think he would probably just maybe take a piece of paper that he'd written and start singing. And that a song would then develop out of that, that would then put into the repertoire. And I feel this is probably one of those songs.
A song, you can only say that it was so full of passion and also very intense.
A great finale for a record. It was to that album perhaps what the end was to the Doors' debut. Elongated, epic, incredible.
People are strange when you're a stranger. Faces look ugly when you're alone. Women seem wicked when you're unwanted. Streets are uneven when you're down, when you're strange. Faces come out of the rain when you're strange. No one remembers your name when you're strange, when you're strange, when you're strange. People are strange when you're a stranger. Faces look ugly when you're alone. Women seem wicked when you're unwanted. Streets are uneven when you're down.
People Are Strange was perhaps the Doors' attempt to recreate the success of Light My Fire, which hadn't been intended as a hit single, but when it was edited down from its longer version, became one. So on each album from then onwards, generally the Doors would try to find something that could come out as a single.
People Are Strange, another good song. That was another Morrison one. I believe it was based on a poem that he'd written.
People Are Strange is another Doors classic. Very intriguing lyrics that probably mean a whole lot today as they did when they were written back in the 60s. People are strange when you're a stranger. Faces are ugly when you're alone. Everyone can relate to some time in their life, maybe Jim more so than others.
You could almost say that he was getting annoyed with the whole idea of being famous and you know, fans coming around and things like that. It seemed like he was sort of poking fun at everybody but the hippies, because people were poking so much fun at the hippies. Maybe I'm wrong, but that's what I took away from it.
At the time, they were still experimenting, and this goes back to on the debut record with Alabama Song, that they include cabaret and various forms of music, not just rock and blues, but Latin and also Oriental music. But I think the exploration of cabaret music again on the second record, it would be something that would be a hallmark of the Doors' music.
The song People Are Strange is weird. It's got a sort of vaudeville 2/4 beat to it.
The way People Are Strange works is it's basically based around two chords, which are E minor and A. But instead of Robbie Krieger playing it just like, he's doing all these intricate parts in between, so it sounds like this. So it's almost like he's playing the bass as well. And I think that's something to do, obviously, with the fact in the early days they didn't have a bass player as such, so he's trying to fill out everything he can by doing bass runs as well with all those bits in between of playing the guitar. So it's kind of like he's playing two instruments, you know.
Chorus reminds me of a band that was around at the time called The Turtles, and they had a song called So Happy Together. The Turtles ended up joining Frank Zappa, so it's a strange connection there. But yeah, it's a bit like the Kinks as well, this song. So maybe they were listening to the Brit invasion that was happening also, because there was lots of sort of slightly more unusual influences going on there. I think they had the ability as a band to soak up other musical ideas as well, and this is one of those songs.
People Are Strange was a reasonably successful single, and they're perhaps on the poppier side of their music.
Wait until the war is over and we're both a little older. Unknown soldier. Breakfast where the news is read, television, children fed, unborn living, living dead. Bullet strikes the helmet's head, and it's all over for the unknown soldier. All over for the unknown soldier.
Waiting for the Sun, the Doors' third album, was probably when a little bit of backlash set in. They had been acclaimed as being fresh, new and different, but by the time of the third album, perhaps the cracks were beginning to show.
It was the Doors' third release. Successful with new fans. A lot of people accuse them as making an album targeted towards teeny boppers or the teen movement.
A lot of fans that I have talked to over the years also thought that this was a departure for the Doors. I don't believe that myself.
I think after two great albums in a row, Strange Days and the debut, it was almost impossible that they could live up to the bar that had been set and the standard that they had achieved for themselves.
They've been touring for the last 2 years. They haven't had time to sit and write or to be playing a lot of different things and having the time to write and produce stuff. And a lot of people claim that this was the problem with this album.
Make a grave for the unknown soldier, nestled in your hollow shoulder. Unknown soldier.
Breakfast where the news is read, television, children fed. Bullet strikes the helmet's head. And it's all over. War is over. It's all over. War is over. Yeah.
Unknown Soldier was typical, perhaps, of the Doors' third album, in as much as people looked at it and said, well, it's rather too closely related to Break On Through to the Other Side. Because they weren't really ringing the changes at this point, people could always look at a song and see, well, maybe it's been done better or earlier on another album.
Unknown Soldier. Wow. There's a stab at the Vietnam War.
The Unknown Soldier, I don't think particularly it was about Vietnam, but it certainly had reference to Vietnam and any other war or anti-war sentiment.
The Unknown Soldier was the first overtly political song Jim wrote, which was not mentioning Vietnam, but, you know, The Unknown Soldier.
At the time, it seemed like the norm. People would come out and they would protest and speak against things. I think the Doors did it in a way that was a little bit subversive. Jim Morrison would provoke people with his lyrics, you know, obviously his references to Jesus and to God. He was baiting the audience, and he basically, I think, wanted them to think for themselves. An Unknown Soldier, it was almost prophetic in a way, because he was using it, an anti-war rant, and blaming the media. And obviously 30 years later, we see what role the media has to play in wars, and I think Jim Morrison was ahead of the game on this one.
I think the claim to fame with that song was when they performed it live, and Jim would recite the little piece of poetry in the middle bit of the song there. He would actually fall to the ground when the guns were fired. He would fall dead to the stage, and that was pretty effectful at the time.
The song The Unknown Soldier is a bit like a little three-act musical, a three-act play. And I think really this song was led by Jim Morrison's idea. I think he probably started singing a melody based around, obviously, his lyrics, and the rest followed. And where they go from the beginning of the tune to the end of the tune, I think could only come from a band that played a lot together and jammed a lot together. So, as I say, it's quite unusual because it is like a little trilogy or a three-act play. Very unusual little piece.
Hello. Hello, I Love You will always be compared with the Kinks, All Day and All of the Night, because the riff is absolutely identical.
Whether they're fans of the Kinks or maybe they're just ripping off the melody because they liked it.
I think the Doors had a bit of a hard time with that because I think some critics pointed that out.
Basically, it's just two chords, which is A major to G major, repeated back and forth with a guitar riff that I'll play in a moment. And then what they do to make it a bit more interesting is they stop, and then Robbie Krieger plays, using a bottleneck, he plays up and down the guitar neck, and they modulate a semitone up to B flat major, and so then it goes B flat to A flat. And I would imagine that's probably Paul Rothschild's, the producer's idea. And it's a great trick, even ABBA use it. Anyway, I'll go back to the original key, which is A, and I'll play the lick that Robbie Krieger played. So that's the lick, and then they go into chords after that. A bottleneck, and then they go up a semitone. Hello, I Love You.
Again, the Doors could be accused of retreading their past. In fact, in this case, they were retreading somebody else's past. But it was the hit single on the album that the Doors and their record company expected to produce each time round.
When the band went in to record this album, they weren't really prepared. And I think a lot of fans noticed this, especially on the song. A catchy number that it is, I think fans kind of thought it wasn't their best effort, and they wrote a lot of the material while they were in the studios, whereas before, they really prepared for each and every album. And I think true fans noticed that it wasn't as good as it could be, but they still liked the song.
It's a great song, and it holds up on its own. And I think it was quite popular on the radio at the time, and they would play it live in concert. They played it on the different TV shows at the time. And I think it did them well, and it was a good song to have on that album.
The song Spanish Caravan, it was great to hear Robbie Krieger playing a bit of Spanish guitar. Obviously, he studied a bit of that. And he even hints a little bit at some Segovia playing there. And he uses what's called a natural minor scale for most of the song. And then when the band come in, even Ray Manzarek hints at some of, I think, his solo from Light My Fire. He reintroduces that into this song. So, you know, it's as if they would take elements of their own material and put them back into other songs, which is great, in a sense, because it's always like a little tip of the hat to something they'd done before.
Spanish Caravan is actually a really great song, very cool song. It starts off with it with this folky kind of style, and in true Doors fashion, it really starts to electrify. Maybe you can compare it to a folk band like the Byrds or Crosby, Stills, Nash & Young. But the way it starts surprises everyone, and then all of a sudden you go, oh, yeah, it's the Doors, because it finally electrifies.
Spanish Caravan was pilloried by, I think it was the LA Free Press, as being perhaps the worst lyric of any rock song they'd ever heard. So I think everyone was aware by the time that Waiting for the Sun had been issued and reviewed, and generally in a downbeat fashion, that something was going to have to change. So the Doors saw that and they made the changes. Thought the Soft Parade was going to be their version of Sgt. Pepper. They were really going to throw everything into the mix and come out with something that was the Doors, but something that hadn't been heard or experienced by their audience before.
Soft Parade album, still produced by Paul Rothchild, but obviously the record company had taken a big bowl of money and chucked it at them because they had strings and they had horns.
I don't think that horns and strings were very well accepted on that album.
The producer at the time wanted to add a bunch of different flavors to the songs.
For true rock fans or true Doors fans, they weren't too impressed by this. They thought maybe they were trying to emulate something that the Beatles did. I think a lot of Doors fans, if you were a Doors fan, you weren't a Beatles fan.
When the Doors put out Soft Parade, I think a lot of people felt that they'd gotten a little too soft. You know, the title was apropos.
It was, I think, in a lot of ways, kind of a step back for the Doors.
Tell All the People was an example of how the Doors were trying to change the formula a little bit. Plenty of brass on the recorded version. It was written by Robbie Krieger, the guitarist.
Tell the People was another Krieger masterpiece. Jim Morrison wasn't a fan of the song, but sang it anyways.
This song was controversial amongst the members of the band.
Jim, I think Tell All the People he thought was kind of political or something, and he didn't want people to think that he was, that he had wrote that, I guess.
Tell All the People is a song that says, can't you see me growing, get your guns. The time has come to follow me down. Jim said, I don't want to have anything to do with that kind of guns revolution. If I sing the song, people are going to think I'm saying, get your guns, follow me down. And Robbie said, well, that's the way I wrote it, and that's the way it's going to stay. And Jim said, okay, well, then that's going to be your song.
From that song on, we credited lyrics individually. So it was clear that Robbie wrote those words.
A lot of people would compare the lyrics to as good as anything that was on the Abbey Road album by the Beatles that came out at the same time. Krieger on this album was really on fire lyrically.
The band was really getting a little sweet in terms of their production and their sound.
It was an attempt really to produce something that maybe hadn't been heard before, but was also commercial enough to really make people sit up and take notice. I think on those basis, it was one of the album's better tracks.
Come on, come on, come on, come on, now touch me, babe. Can't you see that I am not afraid? What was that promise that you made? Why won't you tell me what she said? What was that promise that you made? I'm gonna love you till the heaven stops the rain. I'm gonna love you till the stars fall from the sky for you and I.
I was not happy with Jim Morrison crooning. If I wanted crooning, I'd go to Frank Sinatra.
I never get tired of this song. I always crank it up if I'm in the studio or if I'm in the car. I love this song, Touch Me.
Touch Me was a big radio hit and it did okay for them. Kind of pales compared to some of the other radio singles that they had previous to it.
A lot of people have criticized it because it's sort of, they thought at the time, a blatant commercial attempt at the Doors to have a pop hit. And I mean, well, yeah, it was a pop hit. It crossed a lot of, formats.
I'm gonna love you till the heaven stops the rain. I'm gonna love you till the stars fall from the sky for you and I.
Touch Me is just a great single on its own. Real swinging Doors. And probably a great use of the orchestra on the album, the great sweeping surround sound.
It was interesting that they would go to the effort in arranging all that kind of stuff. It was very cool to see the effects and bringing some... The Doors were a band that you could certainly experiment with and try different things with. So for that, I applaud them. Just a little tough to listen to. It's not tap-your-toe rock and roll stuff.
Maybe Rothchild's decision, maybe the band's decision. But a song that would probably have been okay without the orchestra. It was very poppy, very catchy, but the orchestra just really filled it in.
I'm gonna love you till the stars fall from the sky for you and I.
It's interesting that Touch Me was originally going to be titled Hit Me, which obviously was rather more confrontational. It's also interesting that Jim Morrison was the man who decided it would be Touch Me. I think people think Jim Morrison was basically getting on stage and getting his bits out, and that's how perhaps we view him at this distance. I wasn't ever lucky enough to see him, but he knew that basically to go one step beyond, as it were, might harm the chances of the music being heard. So he was quite happy to rein back a little bit and make it Touch Me rather than Hit Me. Of course, on stage, he would hit anyone and anything he fancied.
Wish for crystal water covers everything in blue. Cool water. Wish for sinful. Our love is beautiful to right back where I
Wishful Sinful is another song written by Robbie Krieger, great songwriter. He joined the band to be the guitar player, and then all of a sudden became a songwriter. And Wishful Sinful is a Robbie Krieger song, and it's about love and sex and like that.
With that song, I tried to really get into the subconscious mind, you know, trying not to write about anything particular, but trying to use images, you know, water and blue, and I think Jim really liked that, you know.
It seemed that Krieger enjoyed life and enjoyed loving, and so there were some simple songs, and Jim probably had to sing them in the way that he had written the lyrics.
It turned out like a Frank Sinatra ballad or something, and very fun to play.
Wishful Sinful is again another Krieger classic. Very upbeat, kind of swinging, great driving bass. A lot of fans think this is one of Jim's finest vocal performances on this song. Not a very popular song, not the hit single that you would hear on the radio all the time, but to true Doors fan, they thought Jim was at his best, yet singing Krieger lyrics.
Song Wild Child, I think the origins came from Morrison's personal experience with a girlfriend whose name escapes me at the time. I don't think it was Pamela Corson. There was one previous to that whose name I can't remember right now. But that one, I mean, you listen to the lyrics with that, and I mean, man had a crazy life with a lot of crazy people, and you know, what more of an appropriate title to call it Wild Child?
The song Wild Child is a really weird song. It's got Ray Manzarek and Robbie Krieger's classical, semi-classical influence and Robbie's blues influence with bottleneck guitar. And then Jim's weird, sort of strange, poetic lyrics on top of it.
Wild Child is another brilliant Doors track, even though it's down-tempo, but it's got a great, great solo by Krieger, a very, very bluesy, almost like a crying solo. That is a highlight to Doors fans who are a fan. Doors fans had a favorite band member. And like I said, Krieger really shined on this album lyrically and with his guitar playing, and he really shines on this song.
Wild child.
The eclecticism of it all seemed to be able to be put together by them into something that you didn't go, that's weird, why is the beginning of the song so completely different from the end? Somehow they made it work, and I think it was all tied together mainly by Jim's raw vocal coming through the whole thing. But very strange, typical Doors.
My name? Robbie Krieger. Age 22 years old.
Occupation?
Guitar.
Robbie Krieger was an interesting guitar player because he had this weird mixture of a bit of jazz, a bit of Spanish classical, and obviously very much soaked in the blues. He used to play Bottleneck as well. But he wasn't a great lead guitar player as such. I mean, just remember Eric Clapton was around, you know, with the Cream, and, you know, they were playing 20-minute guitar solos. Not the sort of thing that Robbie Krieger would do. But yet a very fine guitar player because he managed to capture a vibe, you know, which is much more difficult in many ways than playing hundreds of notes.
Robbie Krieger is a really technically and clean at times, and if he needed to be mean and dirty, he could do that as well. I think it's harder to play cleaner notes than it is to bury him in a whole bunch of fuzz and wah-wah and effects.
That sounds good, Robbie. Here we go.
His influences were different than someone like Clapton, where he could say definitely Clapton was blues music. Whereas I think with Robbie's music, he had a lot different influences there, so nothing sort of really shone out as being predominantly something. It was little mixes of everything. I mean, lots of like a bossa nova beat in their music, stuff like that, Latin rhythms.
If you listen to things like The End, you know, that sort of slightly Indian thing he's doing on that, or Spanish Caravan, the Spanishy thing he's doing on that, the introduction, which was slightly flamenco. He's obviously listened to lots of different music, and he's able to bring it to the band, bring it to the table, as they say, and be very useful as a guitar player.
I think definitely for the band that that Robbie was in, he definitely held it together. He was a great songwriter, and you listen to his fills, and it's pretty amazing stuff.
I remember when I talked to him a couple of years ago, he said that when he goes back and listens to those records, that some of the solos are pretty tough, and he said to me, yeah, I did a pretty good job on those solos, and I have to agree. I mean, you know, and they're there for forever. They're legendary.
Peppermint, Whiskers, chocolate candy, champion socks, and a girl named Sandy. His wife gets home.
The Soft Parade is a five-part suite. It's a suite of disparate pieces that we put together to create a whole.
It has several different sections. It's kind of like an opera.
The track, The Soft Parade, it's quite an unusual track. It's got a 2-4 beat, and then it goes into a sort of bayou sort of groove, and all sorts of strange things going on.
This is the best part of the trip. This is the part I really like it, yeah. Gentle street where people
a tough song to play. It was had so many parts and stuff. And when we recorded it, you know, we did it in sections, so it wasn't something that we had worked out on the road and just brought into the studio, like a lot of our stuff.
The Soft Parade, which is the title track, last song on the album, again, to a lot of fans, probably one of the finest performance songs to wrap up any of the Doors albums. Fans really like this song. Fans really like what the Doors did at the end of every album with that last song, where a lot of albums, you get halfway through the second side and you're kind of going, oh, what's, the Doors didn't do that. They bookended their albums very well with a great song in the beginning and usually an epic song or quite a long song at the end to entice the fan to flip it over and start it again from the beginning.
Sometimes you produce a track in the studio that you know is going to go down well on stage, and Roadhouse Blues was certainly one of those for the Doors. In fact, they liked it so much they would open the shows with it, which was a little bit of a risk, but it's one that really usually paid off.
If you ever wanted a blues hard rock anthem, this song was it.
Roadhouse Blues is a true Doors classic, a song you could sing along to, you can dance to it, you can especially drink to this song.
It's all about drinking beer, heading out in the road.
It's honest and it comes from a real place. It's got a real swagger to it too, and Jim, when he wraps his vocals around it, he's just got that whiskey-drenched sort of vocal that just works with it. It's just a hard-hitting, booze-drinking song.
It sounds like one of the nights in the studio, they all got there together and it was, you know, a good vibe. And the raw power of Jim's vocal, a great blues singer, and that was really coming out. Robbie's sort of slightly odd blues guitar lick.
It showed again what the Doors could do when they put their minds to it, and they churned out, I think, an enduring blues song.
It's just true rock and roll. It's an absolutely fantastic song that really shows them going back to what they do best, which is play straight ahead rock and roll with driving drums, a driving bass beat, and everyone just gelling in perfect harmony.
The other thing I think about the band was that between drums and vocals, there was an understanding. They used to follow each other, and even in a blues song, it would work. So sometimes there was straightforward drumming going on, sometimes there wasn't. And I think this was something that the Doors, they weren't scared to take risks. So it sounded like to me they were having fun during this recording.
Name?
John Densmore.
Age?
23.
Occupation?
Percussionist.
Any drummer playing with the Doors would have to be able to drive them on when they were driving, lay back when Jim Morrison was having one of his rants. The Doors' music had a lot of peaks and troughs, so a drummer would have to listen very carefully to what was going on and basically fit in with the style, unlike, say, Status Quo, where you'd be playing 4-4 straight ahead boogie all the way through the song.
He said something that was really interesting. He said that once during the live performances, he understood that he didn't have to play a backbeat all the time and he could follow Jim's performance. It freed him up to be able to do anything he wanted. And if you listen to his drumming with that in mind, it all starts to make sense.
When you listen to their live stuff and the fact that with Morrison, he never really knew what he was going to do next. So you listen to Densmore's drumming and he's constantly keeping the same beat, and then Morrison may scream and then go into a song without any kind of warning. And I mean, if you've ever been in a band, you know you need that sort of warning or you need a count in or something. And he's always on cue. So you got to give him credit for that. He was really paying attention and listening and could keep a steady beat through all their songs.
Come on, baby, take a chance with us. Come on, baby, take a chance with us.
Let's face it, he's not a Keith Moon or a Bonzo, but certainly credible, and certainly, you know, the rhythm section that was needed, and you can hear on every Doors record that exists.
A lot of people might say, oh, well, you know, some of his fills are a bit dodgy in places, but who cares? It was what he was up to. It was what he was trying to create. He was very creative.
John Densmore was a drummer who basically could rock when he needed to rock, lay back when he needed to lay back, a few jazzy touches here and there. So perhaps he didn't need to be an all-round virtuoso, but when it came to playing his part in Doors music. I think we can say he did that.
If you want to talk about swan songs and fitting finales for a band, the 1971 album L.A. Woman from the Doors is perhaps at the top of the heap. I mean, to go out with a bang, as it were, is exactly what Jim Morrison would do with that record.
L.A. Woman, I think a lot of people might consider that the Doors' masterpiece. Production-wise, it was probably the best album sounding. You could put that on your speakers and it just sounded huge. A lot more, it seemed like the band was delving a lot more into the blues, and they had this sort of psychedelic experimental stuff going on before. It seemed like the blues was really coming out into the forefront.
I would say it's their Dark Side of the Moon. It's their Who's Next. It's their Rumors, if I may use all those as a term to express other groups' greatest achievements.
I think that this whole album, they have a bit more energy again. It's as if they're freed up again to get back to the early days.
Changeling, great song. It's a great record. That's probably the Doors record you could put on and listen to start to finish over and over again.
My favorite album, as I'm growing older and getting into rock music, I heard that Paul Rothschild didn't want to produce this because he thought it was too loungy. So the Doors and Bruce Botnick, the engineer, produced it themselves.
L.A. Woman was the first album that they weren't working with their previous producer, Rothschild. They had a new producer on this album. Rothschild decided not to do it because he thought it sounded too much like lounge music. When the band took him the demos, he kind of thought, well, the last album really rocked, and now you guys are kind of going in a total different direction, and I don't really want to do it.
I know from what I've read about them and, things that have been, films that have been made, et cetera, that things were disintegrating. Yet, still, the recordings on these sessions were very good and exciting. And that raw power was still there.
LA Woman, the title track, obviously a great song in itself, but a real turning point for the band, and it's sad that it came on their final record. But I think that Robbie Krieger shows something that perhaps he hadn't shown earlier, which is just an exploration of the guitar and of his influences. He touches on so many people and goes so many places during this song. He's buoyed by Jim Morrison's performance, which is an absolute classic on this song.
This is a great track. It's got lots of power and energy. And he's singing from his heart.
They also took the opportunity to recruit a rhythm guitarist, Mark Benno, and a bass player, Jerry Sheff, because they weren't really happy with the idea of playing the bass on the keyboard. Sometimes it worked in concert, quite often it didn't. And so what had become a trademark had become a little bit of a liability.
There's just a certain edge and toughness to the whole performance by the whole band. And it does sound like they're playing their hearts out, because this may be the last time they're going to be playing together.
Perfect production. You felt like you were in LA when you put that song on.
Some people say the song is about LA itself. Other people say it's about the Doors' longtime publicist who is from Los Angeles. They think that Jim had dedicated this song to her, who was a secret love of his. Regardless of what the lyrical meaning of the song gets down to, I think that Robbie Krieger's performance in this song is one of his best.
Krieger, who I've spoken to, said that the L.A. Woman track is the quintessential Doors song. They just went into the studio, came up with a riff, moved the thing down to G, and then he didn't know how Morrison came up with the lyrics, but he did. It's such a great song, you know. On a sunny day, the top is down and you're driving with the radio cranked up, and L.A. Woman is just screaming out of the speakers. It's fantastic.
A great track, and one I still listen to this day.
Name?
Raymond Daniel Manzuri.
Age?
Born 2/12/39.
Occupation?
Musician. Organist.
Ray Manzarek was the musical backbone of the Doors to many people. He had a very distinctive style, and part of that was using his left hand to play the bass notes without a proper bass player until the very end of the band. Somebody needed to be holding down the bottom end.
We're getting tired of hanging around here. Waiting around with our heads to the ground.
Ray Manzarek was someone who brought the keyboard to the limelight in a band, whereas usually before they've, keyboard players or organ players have always been sort of standing in the background while the guitar players and bass players and everyone have been up front. But he was the one who, it was like, well, listen to me, I'm playing the riffs here. Don't worry about any of the others. I'm the one who's got the hooks to all the songs and everything.
He was an interesting keyboard player because he used to use this farfisa sound, this sort of slightly, a sound that I never particularly liked, but it was a branding sound for the Doors, to use the modern word. And then he moved over to using Wurlitzer in the later years and a bit of Hammond and things. And once again, with a band like that, he was the right keyboard player for the band. He understood what the band was about.
I think definitely Ray Manzarek's keyboard playing is very unique. It was unlike anything else, and it was probably due to his influences with jazz music.
Ray was a typical musician. He was working for money before the Doors even happened. He was known as Screaming Ray Daniels, and he'd always did it for money. He liked playing, but he was doing it to keep himself alive until he met Jim and met this visionary with great lyrics and thought, hey, we can put this together.
Ray Manzarek was a big part in almost every Doors song. His keyboards is, if not front and center, very, very low in the mix, but a big part nonetheless.
A lot of bands at the time had keyboard players or people that played the organ, but there was definitely a sound to the Doors sound that you know, not other bands couldn't really emulate it.
Everything that he has played over the years on the Doors records sticks out as, you know, his little introductions, his ideas, his musical ideas are all very strong.
An incredible musician and really knew how to play the organ, and there's been no one else like him really who's ever done anything like that.
Clearly the kind of playing that he contributed to the Doors was very much a part of the sound, and I think any other keyboard player there would have had a job making the same impact that he did.
I want to tell you about Texas radio and a big beat. Comes out of the Virginia swamps, cool and slow, with a backbeat narrow and hard to master. Some call it heavenly in its brilliance, others mean and rueful of the Western dream. I love the friends I have gathered together on this thin raft. We've constructed pyramids in honor of our escaping. Well, this is the land where the Pharaoh died.
Texas Radio is a poem about, and John and Robbie and I play behind it, is a poem about rock and roll coming out of the dark, deep swamps of the South with a backbeat narrow and hard to master. Some call it heavenly in its brilliance.
Jim, application.
Morrison, I think, always thought of himself as a poet, as more than a rock star. And I know all throughout his career, he wanted to be taken seriously as a poet. He did release a few books of verse during his lifetime. But I think he was quite disappointed that most people couldn't see beyond this sort of rock star kind of thing.
Jim Morrison was very much a different character on stage and in the studio. If you let him out there in front of an audience, he was one of these consummate showmen. Perhaps an American Mick Jagger, perhaps he was more or less than that.
There's never been anyone else like Jim Morrison, and you know, he was an absolute original and one of these people who left his legacy behind when he died, and will always be thought upon as one of the best frontmen ever.
Jim Morrison was one of those people that you almost love to hate. There was a bit of an ego there to him, but at the same time, I think that's what made the Doors so watchable and such a potent live force.
If you went to see him live, it looked like you never know what would happen. I think that's something that's cool with all the best bands in the world. Always have a dangerous element to them. Whatever it is, there's always a member or more than one member that you never know what could happen next. And that was the appeal of them, I think.
A lot would depend on what day you caught him on. Some days he could be absolutely transcendent, other days disappointing. And I know people who saw him when he came over to London, played at the Roundhouse. People had very differing opinions of what exactly he was presenting. And of course, to them, Jim Morrison more or less was the Doors. So if Jim Morrison disappointed, then they went away with a bad impression of the Doors as a whole, which was very unfair on the other guys, but obviously Jim enjoyed being the centre of attention, and that's exactly what he was.
Something like that.
Don't overblow, Jim. You got a long way to go.
Why not?
I never saw him perform, but by all accounts, he was completely mesmerising and would take the most phenomenal risks, whether it was because he was off his head or not. Some performances he wasn't off his head and he would still take risks. I think he felt that it was a performance in the true sense of the word. And the art performance of that era and the sort of the slightly, you know, the hippie attitude to, you know, performance could go on for as long as the song had to go on for. We'll be right back.
He was electric. He was the Lizard King. He patented the leather pants for the front man. I mean, how can you argue with that? And he was, in some ways, the front man by which all others are judged.
I think he was first a poet and then a performer.
His lyrics, when you read them, you know, they are poetry, and all he's done is written poetry and put it to great music, which is why I think the mix of the Doors as a band, the band side of it, and with him, you know, that's why it gelled so well.
Most of the other people at the time that were producing music or writing music at the time were writing songs, where he was writing poems that were being put to music.
I think most poets want people to hear their work, whether you're by yourself or within a group, and he would be on stage reciting his poetry. It's just that his poems fit so well with the music of the rest of the band, which enabled him and drived him to perform the songs even greater, or perform his poetry to a higher level.
Each house repeats a moan. Windows roll. The beast car locked in against the morning. Smug with semen, eyes in their nipples. Wait! There's been a slaughter here!
I think that's what he would want to be remembered as a poet. And I think as more people look at his music, I think they'll sort of see more of that.
Jim Morrison was a great lyricist. A lot of people thought he was a poet. I thought he was a lyricist more than a poet. I think his lyrics were great because they were simple and to the point. And with that fantastic big voice he had, expressive voice he managed to get simple ideas across. They sounded like sometimes they had a lot more meaning than possibly they did. But that's what rock and roll is all about.
Jim Morrison's lyrics were all about anti-establishment. At the time when people were singing about the flower power and the flower children and nice things, he was singing about the sex and the violence and anything that he shouldn't have been talking about, he would talk about. He was a master of writing true thoughts of what he had seen around him. And then singing it, not caring whether or not it pissed off someone or not.
Storm, riders on the storm, into this house we're born, into this world we're thrown, like a dog without a bone, an actor out alone, riders on the storm.
Riders on the storm. That is another song that people, you know, that's a Doors song. No one else did a song like that with the different sound effects in the song. It adds a real spookiness that you don't really hear in a lot of the songs.
What a mood piece Riders on the Storm is, just with the sound effects.
Think back to when the first time it was when you heard Riders on the Storm, and the way Jim Morrison was able to elicit fear.
A masterpiece of Jim's songwriting as far as his lyrics go and storytelling.
Riders on the Storm is another mini masterpiece, and one of the first times where they overdubbed Jim's vocals twice, singing the exact same line, but in a much lower tone, which gives it that eerie quality of which the way the song starts out.
There's a killer on the road. His brain is squirming like a toad. Take a long holiday. Let your children play. If you give this man a ride, sweet family,
lyrically. There's a killer on the road, his brain is squirming like a toad. You really felt some sort of looming, ominous figure that's gonna come get you. It was like the boogeyman kind of equivalent. And that late into the Doors' career, when Jim had been through so much, he was still a great actor. He could convey those lyrics with great authenticity and actually set a mood that was kind of scary and dark and dangerous.
I mean, a lot of their music was very kind of like dark or kind of dangerous, but definitely with that song, I think it had a lot of images that Morrison was working on. He was working on a play about a fellow who's a hitchhiker who murders a family and takes their car and stuff like this. And here's this song that's basically describing the idea he had for this film.
Just a song that I think really came together well. I'm sure they stood around and sort of scratched their own heads thinking, wow, do we just put this together? This is pretty cool. Because that's just a, you know, a quintessential moment for the Doors.
I think if the Doors haven't gone down as one of the greatest rock bands at this point, they surely will in the future.
I think as the years go by, people will start to rediscover the Doors more. And I mean, I think I've read things that they're more popular today than they were when they were together.
The fact that Doors albums still sell in pretty great quantities today illustrates the fact that people still think that they have some sort of relevance to the music we listen to now.
I firmly believe as long as I'm in the record industry, I will keep selling Doors albums.
People can go out and they can buy all their albums and hear all the kind of music. There's tons of books out about them. And there's a real kind of mystery, you know, there's lots of different things about the Doors that people really find interesting to read about.
A film has been made about them, there's books about them. You know, you can say it's a bit like the Doors, or it should sound a bit like the Doors. You know, they've sold millions of records.
The fact that other bands have taken what they've done and built on it and used it as a cornerstone of their sound proves that the Doors are certainly rated by musicians.
They are highly regarded. And they are one of my favorites. I still find mystery in them. I still find cheekiness. I find art. I find visual, mind-blowing effects from their music.
The beauty of the Doors' music, something new presents itself every time, whether it be a Robbie Krieger lick, a little John Densmore fill, or a Ray Manzarek roll on the keyboards. Obviously, Jim Morrison, we've discovered and delved into all that there is. He's gone off this earth, so there's no more other than our imagination. But I think that musically, something new presents itself in every listen to a Doors record.
You know, I wish I had the fortunate opportunity to have seen this band. When you watch the Doors, be it in black and white or any concert footage, it's pretty fascinating, you know, to watch a guy like Morrison on stage, in whatever state of mind he was in. It's pretty intense, you know, I think what rock and roll was all about and is all about.
When you have somebody like Morrison in the band, he's such a mythical legend now, not unlike, you know, Kurt Cobain and how he seems to be these days, or how his legend seems to be these days, I should say. I think the music is just going to stand the test of time. I think they're also lucky that some of it still sounds pretty damn good, too.
As far as the general public goes, if you were born, say, after 1965, 1970, perhaps the Doors will mean nothing to you, but go raid your parents' CD collection and give yourself a treat.
Each generation that passes, including, you know, mine, which came to it a couple decades after the Doors had run their course, people become huge fans of the Doors, and for whatever reason, it's for different reasons for everybody, but I just think there was something innate in the power of the Doors that resonated with everybody. They still are one of the most talked about bands. A lot of that is due to Jim Morrison, but you cannot devalue what the other band members had to play. I think that when it comes down to it, they will be one of the top 10 greatest rock bands of all time.